Good afternoon, my dear ladies and gentlemen. It gives me a great pleasure to welcome you all on behalf of Institute of Engineers for this valuable seminar on the topic of how to face the professional review exam in confident manner. The most of engineers know about the ISL. They know the location, but majority of them normally do not attend for this kind of very valuable seminars because of their busy schedules. ISL, our institute, conducts lots of seminars in each week, each month and each year. But today I can see this auditorium is full of crowd. Why? Because of you all want to pass for the professional review exam, or you want to take your charter. Am I correct? Okay. In addition to that, I think if you should cooperate with ISL regularly, then it will be a benefit for you all. As a secretary of the Civil Engineer Sectional Committee, we decided to arrange this public lecture for the betterment of all engineers. I would like to briefly outline some of main schedules and programs of the Civil Engineer Sectional Committee. Each month we are arranging some field trips to see very important locations, places for the civil engineers and other engineers. For an example, we arrange the field trip to see the Norectole power plant in the month of January. And also we have visited to Rosel tile factory in the month of February. We went to Lanka tile factory in the month of March. We have organized a technical tour to Hong Kong in the month of August. Last year we went to Russia, and previous year we had a visit to Germany. In this year we are going to arrange a family tour to Egypt also, but up to now those are not finalized. The other important item is our building clinic program. This event is very famous among our engineers. In addition to that, we are arranging some seminars, workshops, public lectures throughout the year. Under this seminar, we would like to cover these important points. What are the eligibility requirement criteria for the PR exam? How to write the training and experience report? How to get a clear idea about the core competency? How to write the logbook? How to face the interview in the correct manner? And how to answer for the paper A and paper B? So now I would like to invite engineer K P I U Dharmapala to conduct this seminar. Before that, I think it is my responsibility to introduce Engineer Dharmapala. Engineer K.P.I. Dharmapala graduated with B.Sc. Engineering degree from the University of Peradeniya in 1979. He holds a diploma in commercial arbitrate obtained from the Institute of Development of the Commercial Law and Practice in 2012. He was elected a member of Institute of Engineers Sri Lanka in 1983 and a fellow in 2001. He was elected a member of Institute of Civil Engineers London in 1997 and a fellow in 2004. He was admitted as a member of the Institute of Engineers Australia in 1991, became a fellow of it in 2005 and a registered professional engineer in 1994. He became a member of the American Society of Civil Engineers in 1991 and a member of Society of Structural Engineers in 1992. He commenced his career in 1978 as a civil engineer at the River Valley Development Board and served as a design engineer and senior project manager until 1985. He joined the Resource Development Consultant Limited as a consultant engineer in 1985, where he served from them until 1994. So, Mr. Engineer Dharmapala, now I warmly welcome you to share your knowledge, experience for this audience. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. Before starting this workshop, I want to tell you something. Today they are going to put this into YouTube. So, if anybody feels sleepy, don't sleep, because everything will be appearing on the YouTube. Before starting this one, I want to know your background. That is, somebody can tell me background means not your family background, your professional background. Actually, anybody has sat for the B paper? No one has sat for the B paper. So, don't feel shy to communicate with me. Some have sat for the B paper. Anybody have sat for the Viva? No one. So, some have sat for the B paper and some have passed. I don't know whether they sat or not. You are not reluctant to talk. So, my main aim is to discuss how to face the professional review in confident manner. So, to be so we have to think before discuss this topic, how to face the professional review in a confident manner. We have to find out reasons why do students fail in the PR exam. Most of the in the course of this workshop, you can see at the end, normally this will take 3 hours. I don't know, because of this we want to start this by 2:30 and we started now already 45 minutes late. There's a delay. So at the latter part of this workshop, I want to show you how our own engineers answered for A paper, how they face the Viva, the common mistakes. You will start laughing, but though you laugh, you will do the same mistake. Most of the candidates, when they come for the Viva, once it is finished, before they leave the examiner room, we are telling, now you are getting the B paper in the A paper in the afternoon. How to write that A paper? Don't make this kind of mistakes, but they are doing the same mistake. If you are those who want to stay some time around 5:30, I will try to cut down some slides and try to achieve those slides as much as possible. Going back to this, why do students fail in the PR examination? The reasons: students do not work hard. First thing, there should be from your side sacrification should be there. This is not my sacrification won't help you. Now today I came leaving my office work, everything because of you. So I am voluntarily doing this course of lectures. The first thing is, candidates or students, do not work hard and prepare adequately. So sometimes they used to come without any preparation, they come. They want to come and face for their viva. They are thinking that this is not so serious that much. But that is not the case. This is a very seriously, institution wants to check your knowledge to a certain extent. The review panel members, they are working as panel members on behalf of the institution, not to show their experience or anything. They have to recommend you whether you are suitable or not to accept that status of chartered engineer. So you have to be in readiness, you have to come prepared to meet the requirements. Students do not work hard and prepare adequately to meet the requirements as you did in the school, university or other examinations. You know how you prepared for GCO level, GCA level, when you were in university examinations, you get together your batchmates or roommates, they discuss common questions like that. But here, that kind of interest is not there. They do not go through PR rules. They do not read technical literature, national newspapers, international journals, are simply not interested in topics other than their own areas of specialization. If you are a road engineer or water supply field or whatever buildings field, you are interested in that field. You are never bothered about what is happening around you. So you can't sit for this B paper and pass if you are having any enough knowledge about the society, engineer's responsibility towards society. That is why he specifically says they do not read technical literature, national newspapers, international journals, or simply not interested in topics other than their areas of specification. So problems faced by candidates, so I am discussing from your side, this your problems. The problems faced by candidates and their weaknesses have been identified to the following. This is what we observe. Poor reading habits, lack of knowledge of common affairs, especially politics, economics and social issues, inability to correctly understand the question. That is very important. You have whether in A paper or B paper, you have to first you have to read the question very carefully, and you have to understand what is the real thing that they expect from that question. So some are writing all unnecessary things. That is not acceptable. You have to very carefully think what is asked in that question, and you have to write to the correct point. Inability to structure structure a response to a question. The question, that is what the real thing, what you have to answer, what is expected from the question. Inability to write clearly and concisely. There are sometimes you are writing without this punctuation marks or anything, full stop every other way, the place where you think to put a full stop or comma, you will put. So that is not the correct way. You have to learn this basic rules of essay writing, where to put this punctuation marks correctly. Problems with the English language, that is also there. You can see from these essays what our engineers previously they have written, how we can communicating their views in written form. Your oral communication abilities tested during the Viva. Your written communication ability is tested during the A paper as well as the B paper. So I said earlier, I said some you have not gone through these professional review rules. So now last October, this professional review rules we review. This is applicable. This is in website. So how many of you have gone through this professional review rules? Can you raise your hand? I think here more than 150 participants are there. Now you can see how many of you have gone through. The easiest, shortest way you are finding is you go and get a report of your senior person in your organization or friend who has sat previously and get that report with the soft copy and you edit that. So because of that you make all these mistakes. When they are checking eligibility, if that person has made any mistake, you are also doing the same mistake. So kindly go through these professional review rules. There it says what are the things that we have to submit, how many copies of these things, how to the report, everything is there. So now I think any person who is other than engineer, anybody is there who is not practicing engineer, who is practicing any other profession, all are engineers. Okay, somebody. Yes, what is your designation in your place, working place?
Geotechnical.
Madam, your designation? Civil engineer. Somebody from there? Yes. You what is your designation? Yes. What is your name?
Project engineer.
Somebody from the left side? Last row. Somebody from last row. Can you tell me your designation? Please loudly.
President
manager. So out of these four people, he said manager, and all others said geotechnical engineer, civil engineer, connected with engineer. Okay. So now tell me who is an engineer.
Now you tell me. You tell me. Geotechnical engineer, or you told civil engineer, or any other. Anybody is free to talk. Tell me who is an engineer.
When you go home, somebody suppose say you are from a very remote area, some school principal's daughter or son, they say loku school mahatya ke dua puta yana ya hai punji mahatya me mokadda oyage tanatura, what do you say? I am an engineer. So now you tell me who is an engineer. Even in your, sometimes in some organizations, some of you get very annoyed. Sometimes you get annoyed because they say miss. Sometimes this miss, they get annoyed because they wanted to the salutation should be madam. Madam give natan tarahan. Okay, but now you tell me why who is an engineer? Now why you all came here today? Come on, talk. Why you are not speaking? So now you have not answered my question. Who is an engineer? Now I am asking why you came here. You came here and wait in the queue and they checked and you came and signed here and now you are here. What an easy task. So why you came here? Why you came here? To participate in
lecture.
So everybody came in that intention. Now he says, because I am not going to ask from everybody, and he says to his intention was to participate for this lecture. Everybody came to with that intention. Why you wanted to participate for this lecture?
To get some idea about our professional.
Professional? Mm-hmm. Suppose if by chance you are successful in this professional review, thereafter what is going to be your position? Now you said you wanted to be a professionally qualified engineer or something, no? Yeah. So after that, what this rule says, if you have gone through these rules, it starts with saying so many things. So that is professionally qualified. You said you wanted to be a professionally qualified engineer. So now you are an engineer, you wanted to be a professionally qualified engineer. So if I ask now, you didn't reply for the who is an engineer. If I ask who is a professionally qualified engineer, definitely nobody will answer for that one. So we will see who is this engineer. Okay, an engineer is a professional practitioner of engineering. You all are practicing engineering now. Concerned with applying scientific knowledge. It is a difference between ordinary in your office. There are clerical hands are there. Various administrative people are there, accountants are there, but you are having what you call this scientific knowledge. Mathematics, famous mathematics, you say we were selected to engineering faculty because of this mathematics. You know mathematics and engineering. Now, professional practitioner of engineering. How you came to this position? Are you accepting that you are very brilliant and bright people? Can you raise your hand those who are not accepting that statement? I said, I am telling that you all are very brilliant and bright person. So if you are not accepting that one, you can raise your hand. That means you all are accepting that you are very bright and knowledgeable people. Why you are saying like that? You have substantiated that. No? Engineers must come up with reasons. Always you have to prove that. Why you are telling that you are bright and very intelligent? This way I think that is the most disadvantage or very lacking part from our engineering. When we ask him something to do, ane mata baya oya yanda ya ne sare karanna man passe karanna. So So don't do like that. So you are professional practitioners. You said now you are professionals. When engineers are concerned, they are professionals. Why? Okay. Can you go back to your memory of during your GC O level class? How many students were there? Nearly 40 or 50 students were there. When you sat for your GC O level, how many of them passed? Definitely you passed. Huh? You passed. So at that time, what were the thoughts came to your mind? Hmm? 40 people were there, say 10 people passed the examination, 10-15 people, among that 10-15 you were there. So at that day, you thought among out of that 40, you are a bright person. Otherwise, you are going into the other category, no? So you passed that exam, some of your friends dropped. You entered into GC A level class with those past people. Though they thought that they are very bright. So after 2 years, you sat for the GC A level examination. What happened? Part of that so-called bright people, they also dropped. But you are lucky still. You passed. You entered into university. So So GC A level, you pass. Some of your O level colleagues who passed the examination, they dropped. So they thought that the day they got this GCA O-level results, they were very bright people, but those bright people also dropped at your GCA level. You entered to university and some of your batchmates missed the batch or repeat the exam. Sometimes very rarely, somehow leaving the university without completing the course. But you managed to complete the course and you passed out as engineers. So now you can see from GC A level, O level, A level, and up to you are completing your degree program, you have shown a very good progress in your knowledge increasing. But until such time, that is passing out from university, you are having theoretical knowledge, very less practical knowledge. That is why I think you are practitioner of engineering. You passed out from university with the very huge engineering knowledge. You are having engineering theories, various theories and various engineering concepts. You know all these things, but one thing is missing, that is your practical knowledge. You know mathematics and scientific knowledge, everything is there. With all these things, now you entered into the society or entered into the industry. Some of your batchmates, they go in some other path, that is the academic path. They go for the higher studies or PhDs or various things. But most of you selected the construction industry. So there only now this problem, you have to face this professional qualification, obtaining professional qualification, everything. Need that practical part of your career. Now you can see the vision is that to develop solutions for technical problems. Engineering design materials, structures, machines and various things. Practically safety and cost. So now engineer should be able to do all these things. He should possess engineering knowledge, mathematics, and to develop solutions to problems, technical problems. You should be able to do designs, materials or structures, machines. While considering the limitations imposed by the practicality, safety and cost. So now you are having an idea, those who didn't know, or I don't know whether you knew this one, but what should be basically an engineer should be fulfilled with these things. If you are capable of exhibiting these things, then you can call as an engineer. So all these things are depend on your what you learned in your universities, your degree program, all your scientific knowledge. So from this point, I said you don't have any very less practical knowledge. From there, you wanted to increase, enhance your practical knowledge. So institution of engineers, they are the people who are solely having this power to grant you, award this status of chartered engineer. You all came here to get some idea how to pass this examination and to become a professionally qualified engineer, or in other words, chartered engineer. So you said that you came for the workshop to listen how to become a professionally qualified engineer. So now, who is a chartered engineer? Now this is simple. Everybody told no civil engineer, geotechnical engineer, materials engineer, project engineer, various things. So with this definition, you can manage with all these engineers. Now who is chartered engineer? A chartered engineer is one who is capable of assuming personal professional responsibility. Personal professional responsibility. If you can't assume any duties or anything, if you can't take professional responsibility, we will discuss what is professional responsibility. If you are not in that position, then you are not suitable to even apply for this examination. So if you are quite confident that you are a person who is having a professional responsibility, you can take professional responsibility for the analysis of application of engineering principles in the fundamental process of investigation, planning, designing, construction, operation, maintenance and management, developing engineering works or plan. So this is the thing, you should be able to take professional responsibility for what? Analysis of application of engineering principles. You know engineering principles when you pass out from the university. Now those you have to apply. You should be able to analyze certain problems using your engineering principles and engineering knowledge. If you are able to do investigations, planning, designing, when you are doing investigation or planning or designing or construction, everywhere you have to use your engineering knowledge. You know that, I will tell you in later, this entire process is going to assess you by what we call competence-based assessment. 5 competences are there. During this viva, we will check whether how far you are competent in this 5 competences. How you are fulfilling your capability of exhibiting us that you are capable of handling these competences. So professional responsibility in these things, that is planning, investigation, design, construction, that's what you are doing, construction and design and planning. So this is in red, we will see what is professional responsibility. a chartered engineer. Now this registration and recognition as a chartered engineer is open to any engineer, you all are engineers, who can demonstrate competence to perform professional work, the necessary standards and commitment to maintain that competence, work within professional codes, participate actively within the profession. Any engineer who is capable of, chartered engineer is open to any engineer who can demonstrate. You should be able to demonstrate competence to perform professional work to the necessary standards and commitment to maintain that competence, work with the professional codes, participate actively within that profession. Competence includes the knowledge, understanding and skills that underpin performance. Engineers become competent through a mixture of education and professional development. Now your education part is over and the balance part is professional development. Now that is what I told, this IESL proposes to introduce a competence-based assessment as part of the existing professional review for engineers seeking registration as chartered engineers. So everything is totally depend on the assessment of five competences. Now you wanted to be a corporate member, this is the requirement. First thing is education, then training, then experience. These are the three things. Now education part is okay. We have undergone training, then experience. There are two different words, training and experience. So if you show that you are fully competent in these three to the council or this representative of IESL, then this chartered engineer, that is not a big there is no rocket science behind this. What is basically check is your training and experience after your graduation. Now this is very important thing, you look into this one. A chartered engineer, he should involve with identification of solutions to problems. That is what we are asking. First competence, second competence, we are asking about solutions to problems. Involve with identification, how you identify this one, how do you give solutions to this one, what are your creative thinking, all these things. Without going for all these primitive things, we expect you to be creatively think new things, a solution to a problem. At your own you have to find out a solution to a problem. Innovative things during your career, you involve with various projects, there you are having this opportunity to demonstrate all these things, apply your knowledge and find out new things, do research and various things. Just because of with the title engineer, don't expect to get the title of chartered engineer. In between this engineer and chartered engineer, first thing you have to identify solutions to problem, then management of projects with significant engineering works with high risk and resource intensive. In a project, how do you manage that project? Management of a project with high risk engineering works, all these things, when you are from the day one after passing out from university, you join some organization, They give various designations, IT engineer, train engineer, whatever thing, and they ask you to involve with some work. But keep that in mind, they are not giving you any responsibility. The very beginning, they are not giving you any responsibility. You have to work under a senior engineer or sometimes construction superintendent or somebody, but you have to work under a certain person and you have to get some experience. That is why earlier slide you can remember said education, training and experience. First part is training. You can't be a responsible person at the beginning. So when you consider that you are at the state of you are in a suitable position to accept this professionally qualified engineer, you at that by that time you need to manage certain projects with high risk and engineering works and everything, responsible for making decisions. And you ask, they say, because I worked as an engineer's representative, I worked as the senior project manager. But when you ask, can you explain where you have made a decision? Then they no answer. The report is there, but they are not in a position to give an answer to this question. Give us a single stage that you have made a judgment or decision. Yeah, judgment. Exercise sound professional engineering judgment. You have to make judgments. Based on that judgment, you have to decide with your past experience or with your knowledge, you can make judgments, correct judgment. Based on that judgment, you can make a decision. So if you really worked in a project, you are really involved in the work, then it won't be a problem for you to answer this question. You have, maybe you have taken so many decisions. Some are correct, some are wrong. But you have to talk the way now you behave, nobody answered. If you are going to keep that silence during the viva also, then that is your aim. So better you have to be very careful what you have done. Okay? When reviewers are asking something about from you, you have to give an answer very confident manner. Don't try to give very vague answers like this, I think, very undoubtful answers. If you are really involved in that work, you must be able to give a very straightforward answer. Some candidates are there when they come out with very high-rise buildings or very large projects like complicated projects, port city or megapolis projects or flyovers, but they are not so many. They have faced so many problems, technical issues, but they have mentioned in the report, but they can't say. So then we have to decide whether this is something is wrong. Either they have written the report is wrong, he has not involved in that work, or she has just in the office, he or she was in the office without giving proper attention to what is happening at site. I can remember a lady engineer came having more than 10 years experience, Road Development Authority. She says, engineer's representative, involved in so many road projects, but practical knowledge. Nil. So ultimately she admitted she was in the office certifying these bills and other things. So don't do that kind of things. If you are not really involved in practical work, don't write those things because you will get caught. Reviewers can understand the way you are answering, they can understand whether you are really involved or not. So be able to communicate his or her ideas clearly, concisely and intelligently. So communicate your ideas clearly and concisely. So in your case, you are not communicating anything at all. Everybody is silent. So you don't do that. When they ask something, you communicate. Because this is a requirement of the IESA. Not my requirement, professional review requirement, your communication ability. I will give a good example. We are looking into this aspect, communication. I conducted a similar workshop in Kurnagel. One candidate or participant from the audience, he raised his hand and said, "Sir, we are good in mathematics. Api ganan walata hari dakshay, ganan hindai api university giye, namuth api rachana liyanna ba." He says, "We have entered into university because of mathematics. We are good mathematicians, but we can't write essays. We are very poor in writing essays. Can't you allow us to write that in Sinhala?" So we have went up to that level. You are professionals, but you have to think, today you are holding a position of site engineer or junior engineer or whatever the thing at junior level, but gradually your position will be elevated to a director or some higher position. There you will have to take decisions, you have to conduct meetings, some foreign parties may come, sometimes you have to go out of the country and represent your organization or the country. There you can't have this mother tongue. As far as the profession is concerned, you have to communicate in good English. That is why we are looking into this communication ability. You are written and oral, both. So first thing is management, decision, judgment, communication. Ability supplies the technical and managerial works of others. So at the beginning, you are at a lower level. You can't give instructions to other people. Keep that in mind. That is why always we are talking about training. First 2 years training. So at this stage, gradually, after completion of these 4 years, you must be in the position to supervise the technical and managerial works of others. At the beginning, you were learning. Even from Basunya, doesn't matter. But it does not mean that you have to keep your mouth shut when Basunya is doing a wrong thing. Your scientific knowledge is still there. Because, suppose a very simple exam, if you are working in a building sector, you are this, you know how to put this reinforcement in the cantilevered beam, main reinforcement, where to put top. If Basunya, they are not about, they don't know about how this is bending, how this is sagging or anything. They use 12 millimeter or 10 millimeter bars here and there. So then if he facing that tension bars in compression section, then you have to correct that. No need to be scared to give instruction to Basunya, because you are 100% sure that your theoretical knowledge is there. So you have to correct that one. So after that, you gradually gathering knowledge from your site work, planning work, organizing other construction work. You know how these people's behavior, labor, and not only labor, your superiors and your subordinates. So all these things you are gradually learning. So thereafter, you gather some knowledge. You are very competent, and at that stage you are in a position to give instruction or manage the work or supervise the work of others also. Then profitable management of the project. You are handling a project, but you have to complete that project, not at any cost, at any time. You have to complete that project within the given time and within the given budgets. That is the difference between engineer and ordinary layman. Anybody can complete a project, take his own time and spending money the way they want. But we never expect from an engineer to do that. You have to finish the project within given target, without wastages and given budget. That is the very important thing, economical manner. Even in your designs or anything, not in your project, we are talking about the economical design. Now we are talking about value engineering, various things. All these things are other people can't do, but you can do. And profitable management of the projects, compliance with the relevant code of ethics. You know code of ethics. IESL is having its own code of ethics. You have to be very conversant about these things, ethics. Don't think this code of ethics are limited only for B paper. During the Viva, we will again asking about this code of ethics. Code of ethics and code of practice, that is when you are doing designs, you are using various codes, BS codes, Euro codes. Those are separate things, but this is code of ethics. Familiar with the relevant legislation in respect of health, safety, risk and environment. This is unlike those days. I can remember when I was a junior engineer, when I worked in Ulidia Dam project. This Rivers Development Board operators, they go and fell all big trees just to put their they want to put their own caravans or anything. So they go and look at a place and they don't worry about this jungle or anything. They clear everything and push those trees into a side. But now you can't do that kind of things. Environmental protection is there, sustainability is there. Being engineers, you must be very well aware of the sustainability and environmental laws and regulations. Health, safety, risk assessment, all these things, you must be very thorough about all these things. Then recognize the social and cultural and environmental impact of professional engineering activities. When you are doing a project, whatever the project, maybe a road project, building project, so you have to plan. You are talking about planning, then execution. Before execution, at the planning stage, you have to think about all these things. Effect of you have recognized the social, cultural and environmental impact. You can't go and demolish a temple or mosque or church or anything what we feel that religious, which are having religious importance. You have to find alternative solutions for those things. The culture is different from the area to area. A person who is from down south, suppose he has to go and work in northern part of the country. So they are having their own culture. If somebody goes and work in eastern province, sometimes Tamils may be there, Muslims may be there. Their culture is different. So you can't go and disturb their culture. You have to think about those things when you are being engineers, when you are doing engineering activities, when you are performing engineering activities, you have to give due consideration for all these things. All these things are in this, included in these five competences. So now all these things, if you are very competent in these, all these things what I told you, then you can say, I am qualified I am fulfilling all these things, therefore I am applying for this examination. If you think that if you are not fulfilling these things, you are yet to be achieve these things, then you have to better to apply for the next examination cycle. Now you can see what are the things expected from a chartered engineer. Are you, tell me, are you fulfilling those things? Are you a good manager? Are you a decision maker? Have you come across various engineering problems and you have given decisions? Have you applied your engineering knowledge, understanding of engineering principles? Have you come across all these things and are you fluent in these things? Tell anybody? Or floating here and there? පොඩ පොඩ තියන ෂේප් කරගන්න පුළුවන් වෙයි කියලා හිතනවා එහෙමද? The most important thing is you have to answer everything in a confident manner, not just try your luck. If you are 100% confident in these things, then that is why I told there is no rocket science behind this. These are simple things that you have already coming across in your day-to-day work. So now you know who is an engineer, who is a chartered engineer. Now you are an engineer, you wanted to be chartered engineer. So to become a chartered engineer, you have to fulfill these things. You have to be, your knowledge should be cover all these things. Other requirements are there, but basically these matters you have to be fulfilled. So these are the seven things that you need to fulfill to obtain the corporate membership. First thing is education. Then we talked about training. Training is divided into two parts. Recognized training. This one is responsible experience. One thing is training, other one is experience. Okay. What is the difference between these two? One thing is, we say recognized training, other one is responsible experience. Now some of you have written the report. You have put these things in nice tables. Experience prior to graduation, experience, recognized training after graduation, then you are writing responsible experience after graduation. So what is the difference between the training and experience? Then you have to submit a design. Then your CPD, continuous professional development, B paper is there, then the interview, then the A paper. All these things you have to fulfill to become a chartered engineer. So this important part is this training. Anyhow, you, without education you can't come here. These are the needs. Then your design, then your continuous professional development, B paper. As I told you, B paper is this code of ethics and other engineering society. That don't limit that to the only for B paper, but right through your lifetime, when you are practicing as an engineer, you need this B paper, what we call testing your engineering society and code of ethics and everything. Then the VIVA, that is mainly we test your knowledge about these five competences. Then the A paper, again to test your communication ability in writing, what you have done, how can you translate that into words, your practical knowledge, how you convey that into written form. Understand that? So these are the things that you need to do. This A paper is entirely different from B paper. So B paper, you are given various topics, engineering society, economics, politics, various things. But A paper is purely based on your experience, what you have done. Two topics will be there, so you have to select one topic and you have to write 1,000 words in 1.5 hours time. IS very keen about, concerned about your communication ability and writing in good English. That is basically about this process of the professional review. So education, normally this will be checked by the secretariat. They go through your certificates and everything. I will skip those things. Training, minimum you need 48 months training, and that we divided into two: recognized training and responsible experience. Training. So in simply, training means, I told you that when you pass the day one, when you pass out from the university and you enter into your working place, I said that somebody is supervising you. Nobody is giving you any responsibility. Someone, you have to work under someone, some senior engineer. So somebody is supervising you whether you are doing correctly. When you are, they will ask you to give a drawing and ask you to check this or BOQ or something. Or they will ask you to prepare a bar schedule or something like that. But they will check whether you have done that correctly. Is that, am I correct? That is what you have done. So that supervision layer, that is at the beginning 100% supervision is there. You are your supervisor is, or your superior engineer, they are looking at you. They are not signing anything, they are a little bit scared whether you are doing any wrong thing or mistake, then there is going to be a very big problem for them. So that supervision is there. But gradually, this supervision level is decreasing with the time. First 6 months they will give you a checking this one, now after that they will give you some other advanced work. You go and supervise the construction work of that small culvert or that foundation of that building like that. So then time goes on, the supervision level decreases. Your responsibility level increases. Decreasing supervision and engaging in task of gradually increasing responsibility. That is what we are expecting. Professional responsibility, I told you earlier, chartered engineer should be able to take the professional responsibility. That is, you can see now how well organized this process. At the beginning you are a trainee. From that trainee position you are going to shoulder or undertake the responsibility, higher responsibility. You have to, sometimes you have to sign for various designs. Sometimes you have to sign for various certification of claims. Your responsibility. Just you can't say sign and after signing mistakenly I have signed that one. Sign means sign. That means you have to take the responsibility. So during the training period, these are things. The professional conduct, code of ethics, all these things I explained. Your responsibility to your employer, your colleagues, other engineers, and to society at large. Areas of your responsibility to your employer, to your working place, your other colleagues, you are having responsibility towards your colleagues, other engineers, and to the society also. That is why I told this all social, health, environmental, all these things are coming with the society. The importance and relevance of this theoretical knowledge to design, construction, operation and everything. Again and again, same thing. Your knowledge is there, you have to apply those things. In maintenance work, investigation work, research work, or design work, or construction work. everywhere you are applying, you are coming with your I can say your dowry from university. The basic theory, they have given you the basic tool, all theories you have to apply. Institution is checking whether you have understood those things, understanding first competencies, understanding of engineering principles. Second one is application of practical application of engineering knowledge. Then management, professional conduct, all these things are well organized, coming in a sequential manner. All these quality control. So when you are performing a job, industrial organizations such as financial, economic, commercial limitations, constraints brought about by the quality and number of staff, availability of material resources, and the need of to conserve the natural environment and the operational and maintenance requirements that may affect engineering decisions. Your decision making based on these things, you have to make decisions. Most of the time we are asking and we want to go and investigate your knowledge regarding your decision making, how you applied your engineering knowledge in decision making or judgment. Safety, welfare, both in relation to employees and general public. The need to understand the point of view of others to promote good personal communication at all levels. Communication, this code of ethics, sound judgment, all these things we discussed, so I skip those things. So this 24 months recognized training and 24 months responsible experience is the key thing. So recognized training is the structured training undergone by a candidate with approved academic qualification as set out in rule number 3.1, approved organization. Approved organization, that you have to be very careful, you have to ensure that whether you are working in an approved organization. Approved means ISL evaluate that particular organization, whether that organization is capable of training undergraduate engineers, training graduate engineers for professional review. So in a design office, certain requirements are there, so institution will check those things and they will grant you that recognition. If that is not the case, then your recognition, your experience won't be considered as recognized. That is why we are talking about recognized training. So there we are checking all these, your design office or your institution have where they are maintaining a structured training program, how they are training these engineers in a consequential manner, whether it is structured manner, that is not limited to one place. They put them in rotation for all aspects, stores, designs, financial matters, planning, then construction. That particular organization should show that they are maintaining this kind of a training program. So now earlier, now I told you this new guidelines are there from last October 2018. Before that, only when we were considering this recognized training and responsible experience, if your place is not recognized, then there was a problem. Institution didn't consider that period. But now this with the new revision, they have given a concession. Category A, those organization who have not applied for approval. The organization have not applied for approval, but may be having necessary resources for approval such as chartered engineers are there, relevant field of fulfillment employment is there, documentary evidence should be there. So all resources are there, but they have not applied. So that is another category, first category. Then the second category is those organizations whose approval has not been. Earlier they obtained the approval, after that particular approval has given to a certain period. After lapse that period, they have not approved for renewal. Then that is another category. Then we see those organizations which have the physical resources but do not have chartered engineers for supervision of the candidate. They are having all resources but they do not have chartered engineers. Then the category D is non-engineering organizations employing engineers. Non-engineering organization, if you are working in a non-engineering organizations like banks and other administrative places, engineers when they are there, all these people, all these candidates from these areas given a concession. This is how the first category, consider the total experience is there, they consider 50% of that one. That is, they have not applied but all resources are there. In that category, now institution decided to consider 50% of the experience. And if you have worked in some other place which is a recognized place, that experience also counted. Then the second one, place what we call that they have applied and they have not renewed, but IESL has decided to take 75% of that experience. However, that organization shall obtain the recognition within a maximum 5 years. They can't keep that on lifetime, but 5 years only. Within that 5 years they have to apply, but within that 5 years we count 75% of their experience. Then the category C, they have to come from the mentor system. They are very clearly says candidate will be required to have 36 months recognized training. Instead of 24 months, they have to go for 36 months training and 24 months responsible experience. Instead of 12 months, their responsible experience should be double. That is for this category 3. Then for non-engineering organizations, says candidates who are employed in non-engineering organization institutions or organizations who have completed 24 months recognized training and 12 months responsible engineering experience or equivalent. But everything is very clearly mentioned in this document. You have to go through these things. If you are coming under that category, you have to select which category you are falling into, and accordingly you have to submit your application. This all we discuss, recognized training, design. You are for civil engineering, 1 year design is compulsory. So this 1 year means 12 months, you can divide into 6 months, that is 6 months. You can go put that into a recognized training period and balance 6 into a responsible experience. Then the other important thing is CPD, continuing professional development. You have to show at least 3 years when you are applying for the examination. At least your last 3 years you should show 36 hours per year continuous professional development. You have to follow IESL courses or any other institution. They are conducting various CPD programs. That is essential for your enhancing your engineering knowledge, or you feel sometimes you are very weak in certain areas of your specialization, then you have to go and follow these experience CPD courses. I told you the secretariat will check your eligibility, and eligibility means education qualification part. Then the other part is checked by a panel, eligibility checking panel. They will mainly check whether you have submitted your reports, everything according to this requirements of this professional review rules. Now I gave you a basic description about this process. Now the essential part is the report. You have to write the report. Report on training. First you have to come in the cover page, front page. The second table of contents with title, number, subtitle, number, page. This should be in a professional manner. You are sitting for a professional examination. So all these things are laid down here. I am just summarizing. So cover page, then the table of contents. In contents, you know how to write a report. There are various variants, items are there, subtitles are there. Very clearly you have to subtitle and page numbers, everything should be there. Then introduction, brief description about your academic and industry career. Very short description. Under that you can say employment record in tabulated form. That means entire thing you have to write in a tabular form. After the brief description, your training experience, you have to state there, employment record in tabular form. Then the second item is summary of recognized training and responsible experience. Summary of recognized training and responsible experience. That is the most important thing. So 2.1, recognized training prior to your graduation. The training is divided into two. 2.1, recognized training prior to graduation. That should be in a table. Then 2.2, recognized training after graduation. Prior to graduation, after graduation, recognized training. That is also you have to put in a table. Then the 2.3, responsible experience after graduation. Responsible. Then now you are coming to after finishing your recognized training, responsible experience after graduation. That is in the 2.31 table. After that, you have to give a statement, the breakdown of total experience. Prior to graduation, field experience, the construction experience this much, design experience this much. You have to show and that you are fulfilling that 24 months, like that. This is the format of this table. First, place of work, duration, month, from to where, inclusive dates, your position, under whom you work, signature of certifying officer. So you have to get the signature of the if your immediate supervisor or superior is there. If he is a chartered engineer, ask him to put his institution seal, rank, and sign that one. This is applicable for all these three tables: prior to graduation, after graduation, recognized training, and responsible experience. This next item is, after writing this, description of projects. Under recognized training, you have stated certain things. So some are writing, they are confusing everything. So they worked as a trainee, but so part they are taking and putting into responsible also. Again, after they are doing responsible training, again part they are taking and again putting that into the recognized training. That is not a good practice. That means if you have finished your training period, that means you have achieved certain level and you are now holding responsible position. So while you are from say 2005 to 2007, you worked as a responsible position, and again you are going 2008 and you put something in the recognized training as a trainee. So that is, you can just think How you are, otherwise you have demoted from your organization for something, or you have done some wrong thing and they have asked you to go and get training again. Otherwise no reason for you go back to that category, recognize training. So when you are writing this report, you have to be careful about these dates. Once you finish your recognized training, then you are going to responsible position. Then that is should be a continuous, but your design you can have. You may be continuously, you may be in 1 year in a design office. You can divide that into two inside the recognized and responsible. But construction and other things, you can't go back to that responsible to recognize that. So here you have to briefly write your project name, who is your employer, organization, contractor, duration, very brief description of the project, your role. When you are writing this role, be careful spellings. Our engineers, role role and role, which is relevant to you. Responsibilities, involvement in specific issues. Most of the time you are writing, I worked in a road project, sub-base thickness is this much, this is the volume of sub-base volume, we use 8 to 10 ton roller vibrator, we went 6 passes and we checked the moisture. That is method statement. We know that if you want to achieve 98% compaction, 98 or 92 or whatever thing, what the thing that you have to do, no need to write all this the way you have adopted, but we are interested in the responsibilities and your involvement in the project, how you solve problems and technical issues, and how you use your scientific knowledge. So this is how to recognize training part. Then responsible training also, similarly you can write these things, brief, same thing, project name, title and everything, and brief description and your responsibilities and involvement. Then very important thing is the achievement of requirements of 5 core competences. This competence, I told you, entire thing is based on this, ISL is testing you based on this 5 competence. So this is the most important thing. There are 5 competences, I told. First one, as I told you, knowledge and understanding of engineering principles, practical applicable engineering knowledge, leadership and management, communication and interpersonal. You can see this fourth competence is communication and interpersonal skill. Communication is very important. Then professional conduct. These are the 5 competences. Under these 5 competences, there are certain elements that is mentioned in this book. Now in this new guideline, in your, when you are submitting your report, you have to substantiate with examples how you achieve these elements under each and every competence. I will show you later. 5 competences are there, there is a table, left hand side these elements are there, other side left blank. So you have to say how you say identify your specific engineering problem. So you have to write from your experience, or you can quote the number of that particular paragraph, saying if you involved in a certain serious engineering problem and you gave decisions, you can very shortly you can write that in this project, in this payment construction asphalt, when you are laying asphalt concrete, some problem was in you involved with some problem. Very briefly you can write, or you can put that relevant paragraph number there. In that paragraph you can explain that one. That is a new addition. You have to, when you are submitting your report, you have to fill that section of that competence achievement. Then CPD, you have to submit your all certificates, participation of IESL activities, that is also very important. Some are looking at IESL at a very they hate this place. I don't know why. In other places they say my organization, my institution. They used to call as my institution, but not everybody. Some are saying I never step into that place. That's a very horrible place or like that. They use all kind of bad words in English to define this place. I don't know why, but this is the place, your Mahakendra of Engineering. So this is the place, only apex body that giving having the powers to award this professional status. You know this Engineering Council is there now. This is the place who recommend you to that Engineering Council. Without Engineering Council registration at Engineering Council, you can't practice in Sri Lanka. So to get the registration, you have to come go through IESL. So all these things are there. So you have to respect this place. We are doing a service to you. Then organization chart, at least last 2-3 organizations where, that is just a reviewer to find out your level, where you work. You say I worked as a project manager, then you have to state who are above you, who are below you. Then they can get idea. If you say anything about I did this and I did that, but they know when these two people are there, what is your duties. Then photographs, if you can attach some photographs, that is more advantageous for evaluation. Then your logbook, you have to maintain this logbook, not the day before the submission of your documents. You take 2 or 3 color ballpoint pens and you write in changing those things to give you an impression that you have written this in various days, but we can understand that you have written this in the 2 or 3 days ago before that one. So you have to maintain your logbook. This is checked when we are coming for this organization recognition. Sometimes we check this one. Then attachment, organization charts, project photographs, any other documents that you feel that is more supportive for your this thing. This report writing, the main objective of this report on training and experience to be demonstrate that the candidate has achieved the degree of professional competence required of a corporate member of the IESL, has the exercise responsibility required level. In the report, the candidate should endeavor to display her, his or her understanding of 5 core competences. That is what we are mainly look into this aspect, that is 5 core competences, not the method how you constructed the road or method that you constructed the building, but how you achieved the requirements of this 5 core competences. That you have to write in this report. This training, responsible training section, this limitation is there. Don't write too much of things. That is why I showed you this each and every thing what you have to essentially should be there. The section should be not less than 2500 words with the maximum of 3000 words. They are doing counting, word counting is done. So if you have written your experience with more than 3000 words, then they will ask to resubmit that one. Please use the following as a guide. Prior to graduation, not more than 250 words. Recognized training, not less than 1000 words. Responsible training, 1000 words. Like that, you have to first plan this and write this report. Don't exceed 3000 words in this report. Then competence section is how you achieve these competences. That is that section you have, you can spare 1500 words to 1700 words. That is more important. achievement of requirements of these five competences. It is very important that report should be well structured. I told how to structure that one. Well written in grammatically correct English. Wherever possible, report should be substantiated with diagrams and tables, graphs, photographs. That I told you. Then corporate member who has to sign the support your application. Now this is a very this actually what I have come across this report. You can see how bad report he has written. He says, I was appointed as a site engineer. The rehabilitation and reconstruction of Andhra Trincomalee Road project. The length of the road is 98 kilometers. My duties and responsibilities were as follows. Surveying and establishment of road center line, TBM, setting out of all road structures, reconstruction of 80 numbers box culverts and 94 numbers in pipe culverts, clearing and grubbing, finding burrow pits, all these things. Can you believe that 98 length of kilometers from Andhra to Trincomalee? He says he handled. If he says the 5 kilometer section of this road divided into ARE or some site engineer or somebody and given full authority to do look after, then we can believe that. Now he says 80 culverts, 94 box culverts, base construction, everything he has done. So don't write this kind of reports. Now the question is how to separate recognized, no recognized training, responsible experience, nothing there. Is this kind of workload for a single person handle? That is another question. So don't write these kind of things. Very realistic thing you have to write, actually what you have done. Don't write the experience of other persons. Avoid this kind of report writing. If work experience involved in similar project, refrain from repeating the same kind. If you worked in so many road projects, don't repeat the same thing. Report only the higher responsibility and managerial levels thereby achieved in competences. That is the important thing. Don't repeat the method statement and everything. Avoid reporting on typical method statements repeatedly. Always try to give an impression that your active involvement and how the responsibility was shouldered by you. This is very important. Competences, achievement of competences and your responsibilities. Okay. Now up to report part I completed basic things. Now next part is presentation and competency based assessment. So we will have a break. I think tea is there. We started 45 minutes delay, so we have cut short this, and if you can come within 10 minutes time, it is appreciated, because I have to show you this how they have written this essays. You won't believe that mistakes, but I want to show them. So because of that, you can go and have your tea and can you come back 4:50? Okay. So this interview. So I gave you a basic description about this whole process and how to write the report, and then interview. Now we see how to face this interview. Interview consists with two parts. That is presentation. Candidate has to do a presentation. 20 minutes allowed for that presentation. Normally, some candidates are coming with 60-40 slides. You have to think about your time limitation. Before coming for presentation, you have to do a rehearsal and see whether can you finish or cover that 20, whatever number of slides that you are having within 20 minutes. So first part is presentation, then after presentation, we just normally start questioning. That is based on this competence, five core competence. So normally, this kind of a schedule is followed. First 5 minutes we will spend, we have to create the environment that this is not a questioning from police or CID from accused. This is most of the candidates are coming with little, they are nervous, some are shivering. So nothing to get scared or anything. This is that is why we want to spend 5 minutes asking your whereabouts, where you work. If a person came from Jaffna, or we will ask Batiklo, we will ask you came last night or like that, to create a good, very good environment. Then we allow asking to do this presentation for 20 minutes. The normal practice is during this presentation, we are not supposed to ask any questions from you. But sometimes some viewers are asking, but I am not agree with that one, because this 20 minutes is totally belongs to you. If we start asking questions, and then you won't be able to do your presentation. So that is why we normally tell them, we during your presentation we will write something that is for our use, that is our notes. Don't consider that that is something against you. Sometimes the candidate thinks this person is writing something, I don't know, is this against me? So that is not the case. We are writing something, unclear thing or anything to clarify later. So this is not a good practice to interrupt the candidate during his presentation. So 20 minutes for presentation, and 5 competences are there. The first 2 competences are essential, compulsory, you have to pass. Out of these 5, you have to first 2 competences, you have to pass, that is mandatory. That grading is there, 2, 3, 5, 4, like that, 1, 2, 3, 4. So to pass, 2 is also pass, but for this first 2 competences, you have to take level 3. Level 3. Then balance 3 there, so out of that 3 you have to take another 3, grade 3 from other competence, then altogether 3 level grade in 3 competences. Balance 2 you can go for 2 or 4 or 3, anything, but there should be minimum 3 level 3 gradings, including first 2 compulsory. So at the closure, again we will spend another 6 minutes or 5 minutes or something. That is, we will again ask from you whether do you feel that we have covered you enough. You came here with certain expectation, whether we have covered you. If you have think that we have not covered certain areas, please tell us, we will cover that also. Otherwise, don't go and tell out when you leave that place and go outside, and don't blame us saying we went with prepared for something and that person asked some other thing, and don't criticize like that. If you feel that you have not covered enough, you tell us, then we will try to cover that also. Then if you add this, you can see 75 minutes. But sometimes when we are questioning, we want to go and ask whether we have to clarify that whether really you are competent, you have achieved that whatever things that you have mentioned in your report, we have to clarify that. So anyhow, within 1 hour or 75 minutes or sometimes 90 minutes will take to finish this viva for a candidate. So during this closure, we will tell you regarding a briefing about the A paper also. During Viva, sometimes we give you some hints about the topics of the A paper. Sometimes we may ask something much more than other matters, that sometimes give you an indication about something about your topic. So some are very bad in the Viva, but sometimes they are very good in their A paper. When their communication is very bad, very poor in the Viva, but they manage to write the essay A paper to acceptable level. So this luckily you can combine all these things at various sittings. Viva, if you pass, that is okay. Then in if you fail in A paper, then you can sit only for that A paper in another sitting. Like that provision is there. But in other countries, say London, if you fail in one, you have to repeat everything in the next sitting. If you pass in your written assignment, if you fail in the Viva, then again you have to sit for both, not the failure. So in that case, you are very lucky. IESL is considering part by part. So after the essay, we will give you some clues about your A paper also. Candidate shall make a 20-minute presentation to the panel members. Should be based on candidate's experience and design. I will show you some good presentations. Don't come with 40-50 slides, and sometimes you are spending much more time in design calculation and everything you are showing. Don't need to have this design calculation and everything. Presentation shall clearly convince the panel members how he achieved the Y competence. This should not be a boring one. You should have your presentation in a very live one, attractive one. Whether it is boring or not, we have to watch that one. We can't say it's boring, you stop and go. But that is a separate thing, but it is up to you to have a good presentation. Normally these questions will start from questioning based on the contents of the presentation. We are normally not going beyond this anything. Everything will be questioned from your report and your presentation. So when you are, I will show you something great. Reviewers will normally cover all the competences during the review interview. It is our duty to cover all five, because we have to assess you on the basis of these five competences. So we can't leave one and assess you on four competences. We have to question on all five. These are the five competences. This is what I told you, that levels, level 1, 2, 3, 4. So level 3 means perform activity in some complex and non-routine situations, significant responsibility or autonomy, can oversee the work of others. That means if you convince the panel members that you have supervisor work with your own experience and knowledge without the little help of your superiors, then you will be given level 3. Like that, this 1, 2, 3, that is increasing level. So before going to this one, I will show you a presentation. So you can see this is a presentation. So first slide is this one, then presentation outline. He says the summary how we must regarding training and design. He has copied that tables also. Now he is going by photographs. You can see this. If you submit these photographs, then the viewers can get an idea of the complexity or nature of this project, what he has handled. Now, this is a bridge across Kaluganga. So this scaffolding arrangement, formwork arrangement, everything is there. Beams launching. Okay. Now you can see this is the pier construction, the river across Mahavali Ganga at Katugastota. Those who are going to Kandy, this new bridge. So you can see that's a very complex project. They have used, but they normally this contractor, they are going by their all typical or primitive methods. Sheet piling. You can see how complex bracings they have used. So all this he wanted to show the nature of the complex nature of this job. So we'll see now. You can see this post tensioning beams, reinforcement arrangement. So you can see this person how he is there. No gloves, no safety shoes, no helmets, nothing. But he tells, I look after all safety matters. I paid concern, my special concern about safety. But here you can see. Now all steel work is going on. Now these people are walking, no safety shoes, nothing, only helmets are there, just for the sake of to show that safety is maintained. So now you can see how they are unsafe conditions they are working. This 30 meter long post tension beam, weight is around 25 to 30 tons. They placed supports these timber logs. This person is there, no helmet, nothing. Again, they are foot. There is a person who is trying to do something below the beam. Now this is beam launching arrangement. We will see what has happened. What happened now? Beam has toppled. When they were doing the before launching. Now the reason, I ask, what's the reason for this failure? Now this has toppled. So he said these timber sleepers are there. One gave, those are very old ones, and given it their way. So broken, and this has toppled. So luckily the people who what you saw earlier was not there at that time, so nothing happened, no casualties, but this has toppled. So the project manager says then who's responsibility? So he says he said that it is the responsibility of construction superintendent. Then who are you? I am project manager. So why you are passing the ball to the construction superintendent? This is your responsibility. You are totally sole responsibility is yours. Anything happen in this project, safety issues or anything, technical law, any failure. So he admitted that it is his leg from his side. So the, after that, he was the project manager for this Murugahakand main dam access road, Ambanganga. Again, another bridge, cylinder sinking caissons. Now you can see again, these people are working.
They are not. No shoes, no helmet, nothing. They are all, no innovative or anything, gunny bags and this shoring, no. Because they don't have steel sheet pipes, they use these things. You see, these people are working without any safety measures. All these, what do you call this, caissons, shuttling, foam work, these are fairly having a weight. If this has fallen to a leg, severe injury will take place. So, but all these people are only other than this person, all are this person working in a height, no helmet, no gloves, nothing. Now again, these people are working in unsafe conditions. You can see, no helmet, nothing, lady engineer, or I don't know, another lady engineer, somebody is there. No helmet, but some cap. All these people are like that. Huh? Their safety arrangement is nil. Now they are going to launch the beam again. Bailey track is there. So somehow they have launched, already launched beams. What has happened? Same project manager, same mistake in different location. This is now what has happened this time. Earlier, that sleepers given it their ways. Now, jack washer has gone and jack failed. Because of that, this beam fallen into a side, luckily not into the river, but to the other side. So, we have to give another credit to this project manager. He have corrected all these things without the knowledge of head office. So that is also there. So he anyhow he managed to correct this one. So you can see after occurring this failure, now day and night again these people are you can see in this slant beam is there, but these people are also with slippers. They are working on this, we are trying to redirect that into the correct position. See, all these people are, so this, what I want to show is, one thing is we want to, he wanted to show about this safety, but safety is not there. So don't show this kind of thing, which are having adverse effect on your presentation. It clearly says it's negligence about safety. He just being the project manager, he never taken any interest about the safety of these workers. And we now they use various materials. They use that jack. Before doing this, it is his duty or the construct, he would have given necessary instruction to ensure that these, whatever the things they are using are properly functioning. So after happening everything, they say that jack has, there was a failure in jack or anything, whatever or something. But those are not acceptable things. Now still they are struggling to correct that one. The chain blocks and various things. You can see they are working all in unsafe conditions. So ultimately they have corrected that one and finally they completed the bridge also. So that is presentation, but these kind of presentations not good for you. One side you want to show that you have done a very complicated complex project, but other side it reflects that your failure in looking into other aspects. So you can see this is another presentation. You can compare this both. Now this is done by a young lady engineer. Very good presentation, very short. Her qualifications given, experience in short form, place of works, about how she now when with this work she is going to show how she attain this requirements of competences. This is the description of work, type of work she has engaged. Now she has worked in SDNCC concrete yard. Now the special this thing is she managed to answer all questions what we asked from her with the help of these diagrams correctly and confidently. That gave us the impression that she really involved in that work. All theories behind this post tensioning, the way they are doing everything, she very in a clever manner, very brilliant girl, she answered all these questions. Reinforcement arrangement, formwork arrangements in a precast yard, concreting arrangement, stacking, some conditions are there. They don't know about the lifting arrangement. If we lift from some wrong position, what will happen? That kind of design engineers are there who worked in nearly more than 10 years in design office, couldn't give answer. Simple retaining wall, how do you check the stability of this structure? Simple thing, this overturning and restoring moment. But 10 years he was in a design office, he was not in a position to answer this question. So stacking, then spun pipe casting of spun pipes, reinforcement and concreting arrangement, other bridge components. So very simply she explained her design. In a road project, competencies, she worked in northern part of the country. Work description, she explained everything, why they use this rock filling, why they use this geotextiles. Here you can see. And other thing is, she proposed contractor to save money. The contractor went doing this work as a typical way in this earth filling in works in marshy areas and other thing, soft ground treatment. So with these nice photographs, she explained everything, some big construction. Now here, this you can see this precast slab arrangement. The contractor went on this gunny bags and everything, dewatering, showering, everything. She initiated, she proposed contractor to go for precasting work. with these slabs and to place these things and save millions of rupees for contractor. So that is, I think, in this tongue and groove construction for construct culvert in segments, tongue and groove. Construction joints with channels, sensor detection, asphalt laying, surface defects. Yeah, you can see surface defect cracks. Sample collection for testing. Night work. Progress review meetings. So you can see these things to support her communication ability and everything. Discussion her safety measures. Now here you can see everybody is wearing these things. All this barricading or safety measures they have taken. Now here this person is there. Poor barricading, she says poor barricading. Gender participation in that particular contract, there was a clause, I think 50% should be workers, at least female. So she highlighted this because she went through all condition of contract. That is why she came out with the slides. Grievance redress mechanisms. You can see this. She has liaised with the irrigation department, Palmyra Authority, Fisheries Department, various places to overcome various issues. Here you can see temple is there, hovel is there, well is there, a statue or something is there. So when they are doing this road, how they look after all these things. Utility shifting. She has to go with water board, telecommunication, CEB, everywhere. Problems encountered, soft ground treatment, boggy areas. She has given a small calculation how she saved money for by proposing some alternative methods. Some other problems, scarcity of rainy season, during rainy season, four numbers of culverts cancelled. Problems encountered, scarcity of water, soil supply. So these are things, then land acquisition problems, about these various sections, gazetting notifications you have to do. So all these things here, which gazette first they have to know, which gazette the last they have to publish, all these numbers. She is very fluent in all these things. These notices, how they publish, section, exhibiting section 2 notice, diminishing boundaries, like that. The presentation should be like that, such a way that it should be help you to describe very easily your experience. I will show this one because some more people will leave this place. Before that, I will show you how this A paper they have written. Though we are telling so many things before leaving the Viva, write in correct English, write short sentences, structure it well, like that. But they went doing this kind of mistakes.
So you can read the Sri Lanka is very small and very beautiful country. You can see how country she has written, C-U-N-T-R-Y country. Our country, now here country, here she has written C-U-N-T-R-Y, here C-O-U-N. Our country geological geological aesthetic situation is very good condition for increasing our country beauty. From here to here, can you read? Our country geological aesthetic situation is very good condition for increasing our country beauty. There has flat terrain. RDA engineer can't write terrain. Rolling terrain, mountain in Rene here. Condition. Hill of the country section including there has flat terrain, rolling terrain, mountain terrain. Hill of the country section including in mountain in terrain. A and B class situated in the hill area. Lot of A and B class situated in the hill area. Some roads are two lane. Engineer's representative, RDA engineer, she doesn't know how to write lane. And others are one lane. The population is growing, but she has written. Then traffic jam is again, I mean time to time she is writing various. Now here growing. Therefore we have to improve the road minimum 2-lane type. Then we are initially identified and first out the improving roads. So one thing is, I don't know, you can think, this is, you all are engineers, you are laughing, but you, I know, 50% of you will do the same mistake. After design engineer come from the site and, so some one thing is, she tried to direct translation from Sinhala to English, the way we are talking. She wanted to translate that to Muslim. But again, it's very unprofessional. We can't expect this kind of mistakes from an engineer having experience more than 5-6 years. This is purely poor English. What can we do for this? Last one. This one. So if you go, no, time is limited, so you can't go like that. So I will show some other things also.
to read this one, especially under code of ethic, especially under code of ethic pointed to mainly serve the people. Under this ethic, always engineer have to concern public also workman. What they are writing this? So here you can see now, we always there when consider the large road rehabilitation project, there were many activities, THEIR, THERE, there difference between how to use this word, like construction, and here again there, every time they are so like that, or starting various things. So there are so many examples we can give. Engineers are trying to make good job like that. All colloquial English. Initially, when the project is starting, make program using project planning. Initially, when the project is starting, make program using project planning. See, he want to express that idea at the beginning, when the commencement of the project, they want to prepare a plan. That is what he want to tell. But how he has expressed that in writing? Initially, when the project is starting, make program using project planning. In month end, he can obtain the progress. Then mark. In the at the end of the month, he want to take mark the progress. That is what he want to tell. But he has written that in month end, maase antimedi can obtain the program. Maase antimedi progress ka kanda bilwa. Okay, I will leave that here. Then mark. It was like a marker. So now you can think after exam they come and say we have done very well and like that. But this is the problem we face. So these are engineers, very brilliant engineers, intelligent people. You can do anything. There is nothing impossible for you. Learning English is not a problem. So I can say one engineer from Kurunagal area, Ambampola side. He first time he failed in the exam A paper. Second time also failed in the exam. So we told him, now first time, second time you fail, you have to improve this. You have to do something. You have to at least go and follow some classes or something. But third time he got through the exam. So Viva also, he is good, communication very good, not very good, but better than the previous attempts. So yes, what you have done? So he said, I spoke with my wife. So who is your wife? She is working as a clerk in the provincial council somewhere. So she is good in English? No. I used to speak with her, but the things keep coming into my mind, I speak with her. So she was listening. So like that, she practice and she get he get used to communicate. By that way, he reduce his mistakes, and at least he can, to a certain extent, he improved his communication ability. So that time he got through that A paper. So if you listening to a radio or TV English medium news or anything or debate or anything, you can learn some more how they are pronouncing, how they are talking like that. So you can read books. That is why at the inception I told that reading journals, newspapers, all these things will help you. So this is regarding these essays. There are so many interesting these things, but not to laugh. But those are mistakes. Can show, but you can see in progress meeting, 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 discussing. All these spellings mistakes, effort. For example, what's the correct word? For an example, carriageway. Again, RDA engineers, they don't know carriageway. Also, see, also, likewise, procedure. Engineers represent that you. So somebody asked for me, are you correcting this in such a serious manner? This is not a serious manner, but this is obviously exhibiting their poor knowledge in communication. So this kind of things are there, but ultimately, so now there is a marking scheme. Okay, this is you can show so many things, but we'll go back to this thing. 6 o'clock. Now this is the form that I told you. Now you have to write something in here. This elements, the item competence one. This is the elements. In your report, you have to write something how you achieved that term. Example of meeting the competences. So now here, maintenance a sound theoretical approach to technology during her design office activities. Like that, that is up to us, right? But you have now write from your experience how you achieve those things. We will check that, and again we have to decide on that whether you have achieved that one. Like that, we have to write. Now after writing that, we have to make a comment on that. Why we gave this just arbitrarily? We can't give this to that. If we have given that thing, we have to substantiate that. For this particular candidate, though the candidate has followed up sound theoretical approach through her career at design office activities, bridge beams, retaining walls and bridge designs, candidate was unable to explain the basic consideration that she has made in the design of reinforcement concrete retaining wall and PAC beam. However, when asked about the theoretical basis of various engineering works, she was considerably struggled. It took her quite some effort to explain the theories such as the forces acting on a concrete retaining wall, concrete abutment, and how she has decided on loads acting on the deck. She was slow to answer questions and unable to explain the concept of notional lanes. Being reviewers, we have to substantiate our decision. Why we gave level 2 to her. Just without looking at her face or your face, we are not giving marks or gradings, but we have to be very impartial. This is not an easy task. We are doing a actually responsible and serious job. Similarly, for second one also, we have to write something like that. That is demonstration of knowledge, application of practical knowledge. In the review, candidate has failed to explain her ability to contribution towards the design and development of engineering solutions. Her obligations of engineering application seems to be confined to the limited scope of work. She had direct experience and she was less certain in the other areas. Her deficiencies in engineering knowledge and understanding transformed into their application. This could lead to problems in selecting techniques, procedures and methods. So this candidate like that, little or no information was provided to support the contribution she has been made towards planning, programming of work or management of the teams involved in her project. She could not explain clearly how she used the skills of her staff and how to monitor the performance of her subordinates. She was unable to give clear answers in a confident manner to the questions posed to her with regards to the quality control of the works. Like that, we have to give reasons. Now, this is the marking scheme. You can see first structuring and presentation. You have to structure this properly, a paper. Under structuring and presentation, four components are there. So each we will give 5 marks. But now with this new document, there is a mandatory marks. You have to obtain minimum 10 marks from that section. That is structuring and presentation, you have to obtain 10. So out of that 10, suppose you can structuring, you can take you can obtain 3 like that. But if you fail in obtaining 10 marks, you are considered as fail candidate. Then relevance of knowledge, there you get 40 marks. Relevance of the contents, the topic is there. If you are, you have to write that in the contents of your essay should be relevant to the topic. Don't write unnecessary things. If you come out with relevant things of the in your essay with the topic, 20 marks is there. In same time you are exhibiting your knowledge about the subject, then another 20 marks is given for that. Then altogether 40 is there. Out of that you have to obtain minimum 20. That is the first part, structuring and presentation. Then 20 is there. Then relevance of the knowledge, relevance and knowledge, 40 is there. Clarity and argument, grammar, syntax and expression, all these things you are getting marks. So ultimately pass marks is 50. So if you write, now you can see how she has written that essay. So if we do marks according to this, I think she won't get nothing more than 15 or 17. That is what has happened. But that particular girl, lady, engineer, that dedication was there. She troubled me. She gave calls to me before the next sitting and asked how to improve her shortcomings, how to write this essay, everything. And first attempt she got 16 or 17 marks. The second attempt she got 70 marks. You won't believe that. That is her dedication. She is from down south. No facilities like you to come here and do reference or anything in remote site. But that is not a good example. You have learned that lesson, take that lesson from her. You now, when you have seen her essay, first essay, how she has written that essay, that same person obtained 72 marks in her subsequent attempt. So this is the marking scheme. Okay. Okay, this is you have to keep in mind, the day belongs to you. This day belongs to you, not to the super panel member or anybody. The day belongs to you and not to the reviewer. Do your maximum to exercise and demonstrate your capabilities to the panel members. Be smart on things that you have done. Do not try to be too smart on things that you have not really done. Okay, so that is finally I have to tell you that you write what you have done only, don't write what you have not done. So my acknowledgement and gratitude to Institute of Engineers Sri Lanka and Institute of Engineers London. So wish you all the best and good luck in your professional career. Thank you.
Only 2 minutes, I kindly ask you to wait.
Where he wanted to come with the friend of the book.
Good evening, Engineer K P I U Dharmapala. He is one of the Vice President of Session 2018-2019. Dear Associate Members, it's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. I, on behalf of the Chairman Civil Engineering Sectional Committee, Professor Ranjit Disanayake, and all the members of Civil Engineering Committee, and on behalf of my extend a very hearty vote of thanks to our guest speaker, Engineer Dharmapala, for raising your important work and sharing the important points on all the components of professional review with our associate members. I also like to express our sincere thanks to Engineer Manjula Samarasinghe for proposing this important topic to March Civil Engineering Sectional Committee. At that meeting, Engineer Professor Ranjit Disanayake, our chairman, requested me to organize this event. This is the result of it. Other than that, Engineer Samarasinghe also requested me to invite you to participate for our Civil Engineering Sectional Committee activities in IESL and join hand with us to serve IESL as well as our country. The Civil Engineering Sectional Committee meeting will be held on last Monday on the Monday of the every month at 5 p.m. IESL. Finally, I would like to take this opportunity to thank Chief Executive Officer Engineer Neela Besekara and his staff for organizing perfect logistic support for this event. Last but not least, we thank you for being with us this evening. Thank you all.